They just don't get it. If you read the Gospel of Mark, the disciples never seem to quite get it. They hear Jesus telling them, this is the way you are to live in the kingdom. But they always say, well, maybe it's not quite that much. Maybe you don't have to give yourself as much as Jesus is saying. What about this? And then they try to kind of use the wisdom of the world to say, this is how we are to live. And every time they do, Jesus has to teach them again. This last time, Jesus has said, I'm going to suffer and die and rise again. This is the third time he says it. And when he says it, what do they say? They think only of the resurrection. They only think of the triumph. So they say, when everything is good, and when you're in your kingdom, when everything is right, we want to be number one and two. That's what James and John say. Jesus says, well, it's not going to be that easy. Oh, we know. It'll be fine. You don't get it. Well, then the rest of the disciples are upset. And I always feel that the other disciples are upset because they didn't think of it first. Because if they would have, they would have gotten there and said before James and John, what about us? Can we be in the first spot? And then Jesus goes on to say, life in the kingdom means that you give of yourself as servants. That you are to be servants. You are to care for others. You are to give of yourself. Because that's what I came to do. I came that you may have life. I came that you may know life. I came to give of myself for all. And if you allow that gift to take root in your heart, you too can be servants. As I was reflecting on all of this this week, I kept on thinking of that little story that Henry Nouwen told back in the 70s, and it made it as part of one of his best-selling books, The Wounded Healer. And the story goes like this. There were some students of a Jewish rabbi who went to the rabbi and said, when is the Messiah going to come? And he said, well, the Messiah is already here. They said, he is. Where is he? Well, he's at the gate with all those who are sick. Just go down there and you'll see him. How will we know him from all the others? Oh, he's the one who unbinds and binds his wounds last after he has helped everyone else. He's the true servant. That's what we are to be. I also heard this week a little thing that, and I can't remember who I heard it from, that really struck me. They said that this couple got married, and at their wedding, they did something different. You know, what most couples do today is they light a candle. Been to a wedding where they light a candle? Pretty much everybody does that. Probably did it at your wedding. If you were married after 75, you lit a candle. Pretty much everybody did. Did you light a candle? I don't remember. I figured you probably did. My nephew didn't light a candle. He poured different colored sand into the... But this couple that I heard about, they washed each other's feet. And I thought, wow, they washed each other's feet. You mean no one was going to be first? They were going to be servants of one another. They were going to serve each other to help one another. They were going to minister to one another in such a way that they drew the best out of each other. You mean that's what they were doing? That's great. I know that's not going to be a big rush at the wedding thing. You know, kids aren't going to go out and say, well, that's what I want to do at my wedding. But I thought it was really touching because the point is they got it. They got it. That's what we are to be. We are to be servants of each other, to help one another, to allow each other to be empowered by our service Because when you truly serve another person, it isn't like a servant that you're one down, you're in a position that's lower than the rest. It isn't even that when you do something for other people, you know, you hang it on the bell, like my grandma used to say. Okay? You do something for somebody and you never let them forget it. But there's also the sense in which you can do something for someone as a servant and you give them the power to help others. You empower them to be servants too. And isn't that what this couple was saying to one another? As we minister and serve each other, perhaps we can teach our children how to minister, how to be servants, how to care. That's the point. Now we've got these little pumpkins here, okay? And we're going to baptize all of them. But our intention is to baptize them into the life of Christ, that they live in the kingdom. And to do that, they must learn to be servants. And where are they going to learn that? They're going to learn it from their parents and their godparents and from everyone in the community, that you and I must be servants to them, to help form them, to help them know the gospel, to help them know how to love, to give of themselves, to not hold back, so that not that they come back and love us, but they love others. That they become servants. That's what we are doing. So we want these little ones to grow in love, that they become servants, so that the answer that each of these parents gave is not, I want my child to go through a ritual. I want my child to live as Christ lives. I want my child to be a servant as Christ is servant. Our prayer is that these little ones get it and understand what it is to live in the kingdom. And that comes because you and I have gotten it and understand it. Let us serve as Christ has served us. Let's stand.